Yeah, welcome to the second part of my presentation. You're new here. You didn't.
I didn't see the first part. No.
Okay, so I will repeat some parts. It's about full stack DNN module development on client and server side with F Sharp. My name is Stefan Kullmann, and I'm working for the German Society for Non-Destructive Testing. And well, we are doing training and qualification, we are running conferences, and I'm doing a lot of stuff for call for papers management with this kind of code base. Actually, I'm not really an F-sharp expert. I started a few years ago writing some scripts to integrate different applications. So, for example, from our ERP system to the accounting system that was transferred with F-sharp. But now for about 1 year, I'm doing mostly of my stuff directly with F-sharp. This was my very first computer, a Sinclair ZX 81. Really liked that it even the keyboard introduced me into the language, because all the keywords were already part of it, and it was so. For example, here's a run command. For go to or something else. I couldn't type. It's just you press the button and there was already go to. And it was really a gentle introduction into programming. And I just put that here because I feel a bit with F sharp now a bit the same. So the question is, why F sharp? Why should I do it? Well, it's a general purpose programming language, functional first. It has a powerful type system, and well, it's also open source meanwhile, and developed by the community. So most parts are already done for the compiler changes are made by the community. Not so much by Microsoft, which also means that they have now a strong focus on .NET Core and C Sharp and the Roslyn compilers. And so when Visual Studio 2017 when came out, F sharp really sucked. So, but the good news is that the community just stepped in, or a special Christoph, who made a plugin for Visual Studio Code called Ironite. And yeah, I will just open here a sample. So it's part open with code. So it has already the support for that language. And it does some nice things to me. So, again here, back to my presentation. Well, it says here also it leads to the pits of success. The mountain of doom is where normally all other developers are. If you make something wrong, you have to, it's getting hard to get back on the hill. The pit of success, if it's really hard to get or make something wrong. Because if it's normally the programs compile, so will run. There are four key concepts of F sharp. It's function oriented and not object oriented. You can do object oriented same as for C#, but you usually don't do it. But it's really good if you want to interact with C# or other .NET libraries, or if you write a lot of fancy F# code and want to use it in C# again. Yeah, you have expressions. For example, if then else is not for control for the control of the flow, but it must return a value. It's more like the in Visual Basic .NET the IIF or the statement with the question mark and double point in C#. I have algebraic data types. I will show it in a minute, and I have pattern matching. So, yeah, what's next? Let's look for a demo. And I just okay, we had fun here at the conference, so that's why I made here a drinking demo. So I've now here, which looks like an enumeration, but it's not really an enumeration. It's called a discriminate union, because you see it here. Now we have also a drink, can be a wine, a whiskey, or a soft drink, or a beer of type beer. And then you can also have records with a name, a favorite drink, or a list of drinks. And I can just say, okay, I declare a person, me, with a name, my favorite drink, soft drinks, of course, and still yet I've drunk nothing. And then I can make also a function. A function is just also a kind of value, which has two parameters, and it takes a drink and a person and returns a person. So this is now here is a syntax for modifying a record. So it's not modifying, it creates a new record with new values within. So it's a new person which has now the drinks is one added in the front of the list. What's also really important is pattern matching, which you see here. I have a drink, which can either be, let's see here, for a press analyzer test, I pass in a person, which has all the drinks, I test, this is a kind of the pipeline sign. And then I have a list.map, which is like the linkU.select statement. And for each drink, this is a lambda construction. For each drink, you test the drink. And whether it's a whiskey, I give it 2 points. If it's a beer, it doesn't matter which beer. This is that underscore, or a wine. Then I get a 1 point, or a soft drink 0 points. So if I remove one statement, it already knows. So I have compiler support for that, because it already knows that I didn't test for beer. Yeah, and I can also it's now supports it. It adds it back. With a failed with statement, okay, I can give it a 1 again. Questions so far?
What do the pipeline sign mean?
Okay, let's say we have a function let add a b equals a plus B. Okay, so I can say let A add 2 and 4, which will then hopefully return 6. We can test it. I can just mark it here, say alt return, and it's copied now to the F-sharp interactive, and it's now here executed, and it says okay, this is a function add, which takes a parameter, two parameters int, and returns an int like a 6, quite sure. But I can also write it different. I can say, okay, let's start with a null. And then say, okay, this pipe is just a pipe and the greater sign, and have a special font which makes it re-enter. It's called Fiera code. It's quite nice also for your C#. You have, for example, if you make an error, it's really nice syntax for C# lambda expressions. And you say, okay, I will add 5. Afterwards, I will add 6. And it returns 11. And that's possible because the syntax is it's quite different. You would normally in C#, you would write it that way. A dot B comma B this now says, oh, it has now here a star inside, which is an indication that's now a tuple of ints. And here actually it's a function which takes an int and returns a function which also has an int, and afterwards it returns an int. And that's a way I can chain it together. So I can here, for example, here have a drink, have a person, and it turns a person. And I can then say, okay, I have me, and I drink a wine, a soft drink, I drink a beer stout, and drink a whiskey, and I can then make a personalizer test. So the personalizer test, again, here it makes the drinks. Just checks for every drink about the alcohol level and says, okay, whiskey is more dangerous than beer and wine, and soft drinks really matter. Then it returns also a list. I make a reduce, which is like a linear aggregate with the function plus. It's the sum up of all the values. Yeah. And then pass it down again to a lambda. So this here, I can also go here and check what is passed here. And it says okay, and pass it int to the level. Okay, here it says okay, I have generic parameters. And this is an int, and it turns level. Okay, I just test that sum, and if it's 0, I say, okay, it's I'm sober, or the personalizer test is sober. If it's just below 5, it's tipsy, or otherwise, I'm drunk. So,
and it will. Will it go from top to bottom, or what's the order? Because 0 is also smaller than 5, of course. So we'll just take the first case that's true.
No, level is just one int. It can't be, it can be only one because I already used all the list of my.
Yeah, but you do the match, and so if it's zero, you're sober.
Yeah.
And it's smaller than five, you're tipsy.
Yes.
And zero is also smaller than five,
yeah.
So.
So you're never sober. You're always tipsy.
Yeah. So that's the question.
Yeah.
Like, if the level is zero.
Yes.
First case is true, but also the second case is true. Zero.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
It takes the first one. Yeah,
right.
Yeah. That's the way it works. So I have here a kind of pattern matching.
Yeah.
And well, so I can give it a test, run it, and then say okay. Here. If I just execute this again, oh, sorry. I'm tipsy. Oh, so let's drink one more whiskey. Or wine. Okay, I'm already drunk, I can't write. Now I'm drunk. Basically, that's the idea. I have already shown you now the type system, the pattern matching, and this is the tools you start to develop with. You don't declare your normally the types. You just say, let C equals 5.0. And already recognized as a float. Yeah, it's similar to the var statement, but it really works good.
How does it, if you scroll a little bit to the upwards?
Yes.
There's a let drink DB, but for some reason, and I can't see why, but it knows that D is of type drink. And P is a type person, but how does it know that? Because you could add a third one and you want it to be an integer, for example.
Yeah, well, he already recognized that I pass in something which has a value like tricks. Mm-hmm. And because I said, okay, I have drinks. that's quite funny because I drink wine. if I remove this, it should. I don't know why. But because I'm already testing. Let's just say it's magic. but it's called type interference, and the compiler then knows which type it is. It's the only match possible here in that script.
How it's being used, and then it knows, it has to be.
And sometimes if it notices conflicts, then it will show you, sorry, can't figure it out or by myself, you have to help me. Some situations that.
Okay, so you can specify it.
You can.
Well.
Okay.
Oh.
Yeah, I could write also let. A
so like using var in C sharp instead of explicitly typing it.
I could write it that way. No, that wouldn't work because.
I can
declare it. Sometimes I have to declare it. Mostly if I pass C sharp objects into it, they can't. The type interferation don't work. So, but if it's it can recognize here, or because I declared it in my scripts, it works really fine. So now the next step is I already introduced it as Fable, and Fable is an F sharp to JavaScript compiler powered by Babel. So I will just go here again, make that drinking example. Just copy that part. And say compile. And now it's compiled to JavaScript. Yeah, it might look a bit strange, but actually it works, and that's all I need to know. It's it uses the Fable the F# compiler services, and it has access to the abstract syntax tree, and that abstract syntax tree is passed over to Babel, and then that generates JavaScript for it. So that's partly the magic. The next step is, okay, is Amish, Fable Amish. It's called Amish because it's there was the Elmlang. Just Google it. Elmlang. This language first introduced that pattern, and all others followed. For example, React with Redux follows also the M pattern. And actually, no, here. Well, it uses .NET Core, and you can install a template which here is the case fable.template.elmish.react, and create a new project. Then you can also install. You have to install the npm dependencies and the .NET dependencies. Make a .NET restore, and then you can run it. But I won't do that now because that was the topic of the former talk, and I don't want to waste too much time on it. It's just that way. A simple counter. A counter has where I can push. I have two buttons, plus and minus, which increments or decrements it. So I define just my model with that type, just an int. And have messages, increment and decrement, and have an init method function which declares the model to null. Then it have a view method which takes the model and pass in a dispatch function, and I have a div which has no attributes, and inside the div there's a button. And on click, I will dispatch the decrement message, and the inner content is just a string with a minus. Then a div which contains the model to string, and again a button for the increment statement. Looks a bit ugly, but you get used of it, and you have in the editor your full intelligence, or you can pass in your HTML, make and say a function, convert my HTML to Elmish, and it all works for you. And then I have to wire it up with an update. Now this is the update function, which gets a message and a model, and then it makes a pattern matched, and if it's the message was increment, it increases the model, decrement, and makes a minus one. Okay, And then I have to connect all that together to make a program. Here's also a console trace where I can get messages of all messages which run in the queue state are passed to the console. It's not needed, but it's really good for debugging. And it runs in a div which or in any element which has the ID Elbish app. Then it runs. Should I do a short demo? No, I have to run out of time. well, the question is, for me, no, there's also something like called the safe stack. It has, which sits on top of that, which has a web server Suave, or which follows an MVC pattern, and it uses Azure for data and Fable and Elmish, and it's totally perfect to write applications with it. So the real question is not why DNN, why F sharp, but why DNN for me. Rob already said yesterday, okay, we love DNN because we have so much features. We can have editors, we can set up content, we have all the theming and all the other stuff. For me, it's a bit different aspect. If I see it as an application host, the modules are really independent from each other. I see it, each module can be, or a set of modules, a bounded context, if you think of domain-driven design. And I can, for some things I can just use too sexy, for some I make a web form, or for some more complicated stuff, I use Elmish and the web API. So let's make a simple demo, a to-do list. This is the features. Registered users can add tasks with a description. They can complete tasks, they can delete tasks, all users see a list, and they can refresh that list. Okay, let's have a look how it samples. Okay. Let's start here. I have in that folder I have my DNN set up. Okay, I will switch it here to I have two projects here now. See the DNN part, and I have here now a script called share types. Okay, I'm gonna make some declarations. Okay, I just want to say ID is just for me an alias for a GUID. A to-do item is has a record which has an ID. A task is a string and a statement for a complete. And I want to send commands over the web API which just say add a to-do item or delete it for the ID. Complete it for the ID, or I want to query something from the system. I do either a command which makes side effects, or I make a query to get some data. So I have two types of queries: item query, which should return a list of items of to-do items, or can I edit? Am I allowed to edit? Which returns a bool. Yeah. And now I have a controller forget everything here. It's just to get this part is to get nice JSON. If you have some special types, for example, these discriminant unions would look ugly with the default Newton soft, and this ensures that it's really nice. I can set up a route. I have to register out. This is the same as in C#. It just looks a bit different. Yeah, I have to set up that method and say, okay, for that namespace, you have a connect to do. What's that parameter? The multiple folder name, and yeah, and then I have an item controller, which inherits from framework controller, which is just the DNN API controller configured for the nice JSON. And it has two methods, query and commands. And if it gets a query, I do an item, it makes again a pattern match. Okay, if I want an item query, I get some logic which gets that list. Or I check whether the user exists and is in the role registered users. Or for the commands, I say, okay, add item, delete item, or complete. I also pass it to the logic, and it's already here. Restricted well by the attribute to just the registered users.
Because you reference the DLL, the .nu, DLL?
Yes. Actually, reference is a good topic. How do I do that? There's something which is really also good for C#. There's a special something, Packet. Have you ever heard of Packet? No? Okay, well, I will just show you. I have here a packet of dependencies which say, okay, this is my source, NuGet, and these are all my NuGet packages. Yeah, and then I can say, okay, I want .NET New Core, I want .NET New Web, and actually, it's .NET Core and .NET New Web says, okay, we also need Web API and Web API.core, which it's quite stupid because it doesn't declare the number. So if you don't say 5.2.3, it would return a two new version of the system.web, or at least a newer one than which is distributed to .NET Core to .NET Nuke, yeah, and then I go to the folders. You have my where my project is, and I say, okay, this project has the name package.references, and I say, okay, it uses now .NET Core, .NET Nuke Web, the Web API, and the Fable JSON converter, and then I say. Dot packet / packet install, and it downloads all the references, and it also sets up the project, which is also quite funny. Because it's just here a special import project with the targets, and that's all. It's quite easy, and you really, really love it to control your dependencies. It's the first time you get control of your dependencies. It's not possible with NuGet alone, because now you can declare all the version numbers you need. Okay, let's go back to the code. The logic is just here, I need to define to-do item info, and I'm using here DAL2. So I set up a table name, a primary key with auto increment false because the GUID, a scope module ID, and here's a new parameter CLI mutable. Because I already told you this record can't be modified. And but now you say, okay, it can't be modified in F sharp, but you can do it in C sharp or other languages. Then it works also with Peter Perko. I have a repository which gets the instance, and I can request the repository. And yeah. Yeah, it's quite the same. I have now here the new record and say repository insert. Or for complete, I just have the idea and I get the user ID and I say, okay, go to the repository, get it by ID and modify these flags and then update it again. Sure. Okay. This is all needed for DNN. On the other side, or on the client side, I have also here a reference to the same share type, .fs, or I have here in my DNN file. So I'm reusing the same code here, the code definition. I have here some interop. Which says, okay, I want to speak with the service framework. And the service framework has some methods, get service root to set up the module headers. It's just access to the JavaScript jQuery dot service framework. And then I have an API. If it gets a command, it makes a promise, it calculates the URL, set up some properties, for example, the credentials, the headers from the DNN service framework, and it fetches it, and the response is not okay. I will fail this with the status text. Otherwise, I will return the command.
What does the fail with do exactly?
It raises an exception, and then as it's now a promise. It will go to the error pass.
Right. So, but it will it throw an actual exception like in C sharp, or will it have a certain return value like its maybe type?
Ah.
That makes sense. Will it do that? Will it return with the value?
Just return here with a status text. Okay, status text. I know I shouldn't do that anymore in HTTP 2, but I can also with.
Like adding the fail with statement in a function, would that change the return type of that function?
No, because I have also, this is here a class, a client, which is initialized with the module ID, and this private methods here, handle and query. And here I have my outer member function will say, okay, it's a special command with the parameter handle. It passes in the command, and on success, it goes the handled way. On failure, it goes the fetch failed way. And these are just messages. So I have a handled of command or fetched of query result. And query result was already defined in the shared assembly. And a fetch failed is of type exception.
Okay, so the, if you use failed with, it will return a type exception.
Yes.
Right. And then so that one gets caught and used here again.
Yeah, okay, yes. Then I have my main app, I have my model, which has a list of tasks, optional. It can have a list, or if I start it, I have no list, because I have to retrieve it from the database first. And I have a new task, which just the string, the description, and this maybe not set. And I have a module ID, I have the can edit, and I have the error message which is set or not. And then I have my messages, which is the API messages I defined in API, or I've changed the string, or I've dispatched here an add new task, or asked for a refresh. Or I said, okay, this item is completed, or please complete this item, or delete this item, or the idea of that item. Then I have an init method where I set up the module, and I say, okay, I have no task, I have no new task, I have a module ID, I can edit is false, and the error message is also false. And then I make a command with batches now to the API and say, okay, client, I make a query, I want an item, my items, and I want to know whether I can edit it. So, which then goes to the update message. It now also passes here the messages, okay. For example, if I fetched a result, the result is either of type item or of type can edit, and I modify here my model and say, okay, I now know my task, or I can edit or not. This is again a pattern matching. If I make something new here, blah, 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 it will directly complain that I have not handled the new message, which is the pit of success. So because it already says to me, I'm not ready yet. Okay. So, for the IPA message, I say, okay, it was handled. Okay, I've added or deleted or completed it. Then I modify my already cached tasks. So if I get the success message for delete, then I go through the tasks and filter for that element that was modified and say, okay, this is now deleted or completed or something else. Yeah. And I have my view. Okay, if I just it just checks here, has it an error message? Error message is an optional string. If it has one, I will just render a div with that error message. Otherwise, I will go further and examine here my model and go here through all the tasks and will render it in a list. And actually, if I also can edit, I will also render a view for a new field. I just give it a run. This is a .NET fable yarn minus start. Sets up the Webpack dev server, and my spa module looks like this. It has just an forgery token, and the JavaScript says, okay, go to my localhost.8080, where the bundle GS file is, and you, please place that on the bottom, and yeah, this is a div, and I pass here with the data minus module ID, I pass in the module ID. This is all what I need. And then I can hopefully okay, I've already a list. Okay, make samples for talks. I stop. I can't hit that button because I'm not logged in. Therefore, I'm not a registered user. Okay, I've also made my slides for my talk. Convert the into .NET Core? No. Sorry. Can't do that. Yeah. So I've only 10 minutes left.
Can you go to the index HTML that you had there, or?
Sure.
So that's index HTML, and how?
This is I just referenced as this is placed in yeah, I know into my desktop modules. It's already copied before into through my desktop modules folder, and I know I don't need to modify it. Just for if I go to production, I would not say localhost, but the path to my bundled file. That's it. More questions so far? My problem is here, okay, how do we get DNN to .NET Core? We have to motivate the people. And now it's a bit complicated. Nick made yesterday a demo where he's with Ethereum and you can donate money for tasks. Okay, let's add a button, donate BS. Let's record that. Maybe then it gets paid. So, event sourced in 10 minutes is a bit. It won't work, won't it? No, I should leave that. But that's what I do afterwards. I just posted my state directly into the table before. But I could also say, okay, let's focus on my business domain. What's really important are my domain events, which are here in Jello. I have created a task, I've completed a task, or I deleted a task. That's what I need to know. And I just record these events and store it in an event store. Just the table with the serialized events. And all other things are projections against that store. I would like to have more time because it works that way. We have a user which sends a command, and then we have a domain model which it's already loaded with all the history of the events for that aggregate before, and then it can decide whether it returns one or more or zero events, and or for the next view it's just a projection against the list of these events. Projection is just a fold of all the history against it to compile the state. And I've prepared a simple demo, but 5 minutes won't work.
Maybe you can answer the question, what will you miss most when you would stop using F-sharp?
Actually, it gets me always on the right track. It's not only F-sharp, but if I will open that code just to show it. Okay, I know. I now pass in a command, gets an idea, and then I have a command handle which then calculates whether it's an event or not. And afterwards, I can react on that. For example, if someone completed a task, I can make a projection, okay, what are the donations, how much beer should that user get? And then I can say notify that user and send him a message. It's a lot of code, but I have a clean separation of concerns. I most times avoid side effects at all. Side effects are just happening here at that place, okay? If it has to send an email, or modify a database or something else, it's just happens in this tiddy code. All other stuff is just functions and composition of functions. If I have to add a new feature, I just say, okay, I have a new command, I have a new event, add it to the discriminant union, and my code says, okay, it says red, because I have not, it shows me everywhere where I have to complete the pattern matches. So I'm strictly on my track to solve my problem. And I'm also managing my department And I'm doing this here mostly on my own, and I get a lot of distracted. And I go back and I see, okay, that's what I still have to do. That's why I like it. And for me, it's I can't think of another way. But there are also other projects currently around which goes a similar way, which also follows the Elmish pattern, but includes Razor scripts for the view, and then renders everything directly to compiles everything directly to WebAssembly. So no more JavaScript. You just put a compiled file for it, and that's the way for the future. There's currently a lot of activity to write a follow-up version of this fable to have better JavaScript tree shaking to reduce the amount or the size of the bundled file. There are a lot of people active. I already said before, this Ionite plugin is also Fable Elmish based and runs here in the Visual Studio Code. And what I also like is that I have my integration point to DNN. It's just my service controller. And here in that place where I react on the domain events, because this is the only side effects. All the other part would work also with .NET Core. So if I once have to decide to go to a different platform, different CMS, I can. My business logic is not affected. Yeah, I hope you enjoyed it.
Quick question. So,
yeah.
Have you had cases where you had so many side effects that you felt the need to further decompose it somehow? Like, let's say you're adjusting something in the database and sending like emails in different cases and maybe something else where...
Yeah, and payment providers and all that stuff, yeah. It's
because like, would you do it like all in place here? Like,
No. This is just for a demo. Normally, I have just my source of events, and I have use a kind of subscription, and I will attach my event handlers. So this is my event handler for the accounting system, the event handler for the payment providers, so the event handlers for my read model and caching and so on. So it's not that easy, but it feels like that because it's a nice architecture pattern, and you are really good guided, but you can also